received him. To them gave he power or authority to become the sons of God. To as many as believed on him. Not born by the will of man, nor the will of the flesh, but of God. But of God. And in his mercy and his love, his tender care for us, he brought us in. He adopted us into the family of God. We who were unholy, we who were unworthy, we who were so darkened by sin and messed up by this world, and yet his grace reached through all of that darkness and brought us into marvelous light and made us the sons of God, that we should show forth the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into that marvelous light. And so this morning I'm here to tell you, we are honored to be his children. It's no light thing to say I am a child of God. If anything should make you weep, if anything should make you thankful and grateful, if anything should bring you to your knees, appreciation, to think where you were and where you are now, I can't explain it. All I know is I am a child of God. And it's all because of his grace and love and mercy to me. And when I sing that, I got to hold back the tears of gratefulness that I'm where I'm at tonight because of him.
Yes.
Without him, I don't even want to imagine where I'd be. Lord, I thank you for your grace and mercy. Lord, it reaches out to us who sometimes we're the most pitiful, wretched, putrefying people in the world. We stink with our sin. We've despised you. We've been haters of you, enemies, foes, not friends, going against God continually. Yet, in your mercy, you plow through all of that and reach out and embrace us as prodigals, running back to you as complete lepers and cripples and wasted lives, and reach out and embrace us and throw us into the family of God and make us your sons and daughters. Lord, I thank you for that grace. Not only do you make us your sons and daughters, you begin to take care of us, you keep us, you heal us, you help us. Give us strength to face every day. Oh Lord, you flood our hearts with your joy and your peace and your love. In the good times and the bad times, we thank you. You're there with us. You never leave us. You never forsake us. We can always count on you. At the darkest moment, we can look up and you will be there. And I thank you for that, Lord. You're so rich in your mercy. So rich in your grace. So abundant it never runs out, Lord. Always overflowing to your children. And I thank you that we can look to you. Know that we're your children. God, I pray this morning in a special way you'd wrap your arms around those that are going through such dark, difficult moments. Embrace Mike and Brenda. Lord, embrace them right now and let them know you love them and that they're your children. They know that, but just do it again, Lord, this morning. Do it again right now. Wrap your arms around George. You see his text this morning that he sent to me and his longing for a closer walk with you. God, I pray you bring him peace this morning and comfort and assurance of his salvation. Do a work of grace in George's life this morning. And I'll praise you for that, Lord. Thank you for what you've done for Greg and Kelly, that hospital room, and how they're looking to you now, and how their life has been transformed through this sickness to a place where they've humbled themselves and accepted you. Yeah. Lord, I pray that they would serve you the rest of their lives. Let them know that they're now your sons and your daughters. And God, that they would live that life that would bring glory and honor to you. Lord, I praise you for that. Lord, we lift up all those that are not with us this morning for various reasons. The struggles they're facing. Keep your hand upon Randy, God. He's been through such a battle. Yet, Lord, he is your son. Wrap your arms around him, Lord. And Don and Sam and all that they've been through, God. And we think, Lord, of Rachel, the father, and the things that she's been through this last couple weeks, Lord, with the hospitalization and the thought was a tumor. They don't even know exactly what all is going on, high blood pressure. Father, let her heart be tender to come to you. Lord, that she would know the grace of God. I believe that's why you're allowing all these things to go wrong in her life. Help us to touch her heart with faith and love. And bring Rachel to the Lord. We praise you for that. And God, I pray that you bless our church. Wrap your arms around us, God. Let us leave this morning filled with you. Filled to overflowing. And I'll praise you for it. Be with us and bless this word in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Sometimes it's hard to see my message. My eyes get wet sometimes. Just in appreciating how good God is. My mother-in-law, I guess I got that from her. She was my first Sunday school teacher. She'll start talking about the goodness of the Lord. She'll always break down and start crying every time. If she stands up to testify, all she's going to do is open her mouth. And all of a sudden, you sense the grace of God that's flowing through her. After 87 years, she has not ever lost that sense of God's goodness to her. And I never want to lose it. I want to be thankful to God till the day I die. I want to be able to lift my eyes and say, Jesus, thank you for such a rich and wonderful life that you've given to me. Amen? If you live your life for him, you'll be able to say that at the end. Well, we're doing a series on empty, and we did the empty tomb, and then David did such a wonderful job with the empty life and emptying our life up so that God can fill it up. And we love that illustration. Hope you all remember that and take that with you. And the part I like the most about it is he used scrap paper to do that. How many of you all know you're nothing but scrap? Huh? You're nothing but scrap until God gets a hold of you and places you in his will, and then you become very valuable in his sight. But turn in your Bibles if you would. We're going to be talking about the full house. You say, well, we're doing a message on the empty. That's what I'm going to call it, the full house, or the full marriage. However you want to call it, full marriage. Because I look at marriages today and I see so many of them are empty. They're empty. I mean, messed up. We're living through a period of historic change in America's culture and in our family life. It's just unbelievable. We have fathers that are working while the mothers keep the house. The fathers and the mothers are both working away from the home. Or you have single parents and second marriages bringing children together from unrelated backgrounds and childless couples and unmarried couples and with and without children. And some don't want them, some do want them. And some never have a kid. And then you have the gays and the lesbians mixing all this in. And kids are growing up and the schools are teaching them. This is all wonderful. Just choose whatever road you want to go down in the area of marriage, and you'll just have a happy, wonderful, flourishing life. And the appeal, though, is evident everywhere in our culture. Babies are having babies. Huh? And kids are refusing to grow up and leave home. They're still there. They won't go home. Yeah, those that are more interested in their fine cars and their BMWs and everything than they are in their own children. It's crazy. We have the rich and the poor alike wasting their lives out there on the streets in drugs and alcohol. Doesn't have just to be the bum in the slums. We have people, affluent people. Plano, Texas is one of the richest communities in our country, and it is the seat of drug problems in Plano, Texas. And you name it around the world, I'm telling you, we've got a messed up world and families that are being ripped apart, torn apart, confused, emptied of every kind of value. emptied of any kind of love or peace or joy. Anything else is absolute turmoil in most of our homes. It is a tragic mess. It is a shame that we've gotten that far away from God's expectations for marriage. He came that our marriages might be filled to overflowing. He came that our marriages and our relationships with our spouses and with our family would be filled to all, to complete capacity. It was never God's design for this world to be living in such an empty shell, unrelated. We have neighbors that don't even know who their neighbors are. I cut my neighbor's yard. I go, I get to know, I did that right away. First thing I did, I got to know my neighbors and let them know, hey, I'm in town, you need me, I'll be there for you, because I wanted to create those kind of relationships and build like a community around me, even in my neighborhood, how much more in my family. But I know families that have not spoken to their brothers or their sisters or their mothers or their fathers in years. Have nothing to do with them. Some bitterness, some grievance, something that went wrong years ago. And it just, they harbor it and it hinders it, kills them, and empties them of life. And they go through life miserable. Have you met anybody like that? Maybe it's just me. I'm just this way. But I'm telling you, now everybody does what they want to do in relationships, and especially in marriage. And it's absolutely crazy what's going on in this world. Reminds me of the tombstone that was put on Adam's grave. Did you know that? He says, at least I listened to my wife. Did you know that was on Adam's tombstone? Did you get that, ladies? At least I listened to my wife. And he put on her tombstone, I married what was once the perfect man. Never happened again, and it will never happen again. Amen. Because men keep listening to their wives. No. Something has gone wrong and messed up this whole thing, and I believe with all my heart it's because we have gotten away from God's way, and we're going it wrong. We're doing things our way instead of God's way, and when we do, our lives will never be filled up, and our marriages will be a disaster, and that's just what's going to happen. And I keep telling people, it's either God's way or the highway. You want to choose the highway, get on it and run. But I'm telling you, at the end of the day, it will run out. And there's no bridge over. It's a disaster. It's a crash. It's a train wreck. And that's what we're having in all of our marriages around this country nowadays. And it's like they want to jump in and jump out, jump in and jump out, and marry one day and divorce the next day and marry someone. And sometimes they're marrying before they even get divorced. I feel sorry for the legal system here trying to sort it all out, making sure they're really divorced so they can get married again. And so they keep making it easier and easier and easier. So now they can just jump in and jump out. In fact, when they jump in with the intention of jumping out. Is this the truth?
Amen.
And we just see, it's just creating empty marriages everywhere. Void of love, void of peace, void of joy, void of God. Just tragic. And the more we love divorce, the more God hates it. Satan loves divorce. But God's word says it is an abomination. He hates. The Bible says he hates divorce. Now, I know some of you divorced and remarried. I'm not here to beat your head over because I love you. And God loves you too. But that doesn't mean he loves divorce. We work with what we got, and we're all broken people. We've all come from messed up backgrounds and everything else. And thank God I'm not divorced. My wife should have left me several times or killed me, one of the two. She didn't. We kept it together. And nothing's easy, believe me, in keeping any marriage together. And any marriage that's been kept together for 40 years needs to have the hand clap, because I'm telling you, it means something great to God. Amen. And, we're coming up on 43. Wait, Susie, you just did what?
48.
40 what? You're not that old yet, are you? You're not that old. How old are you? No. 48 years? Wow. It's great. They get, you know, when you hit 50 years of marriage, you get a bouquet of flowers from this church from brother and sister Roy. You got 2 more years to go. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you, things are in a mess, and it's not getting any better. Satan is out to destroy the home. I want to read these verses to you, and then I want to share some thoughts. And if there's ever a chapter in the Bible that dealt with marriage, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 7. He covers the singles and the married and the divorced and the whole gamut. From the beginning to the end. We're only going to do the first 5 verses, or I'd be here all week teaching on this. But I want to just read the first 5 verses. I want to talk about the full marriage, the marriage that God wants, tends us to have as His children. Amen? As we follow Him. And God can do this. And maybe you're in a divorce or a remarriage now. Hey, start new. Begin to do it God's way. Things change. I've seen divorced couples and come back and got married and started doing it God's way and became happy and lived together peacefully and joyously for the next 30, 40 years. And I know others that repeat it over and over and over again. They never get it. I hope this morning you get it. So no matter when you start, just start doing it God's way. And guess what? God's way always works. Amen? Can you say that with me? God's way always works. Hallelujah. And Brother Phillips will tell me amen for that. And he married and stayed married, lost his first wife, lost his second wife. He was faithful unto death and loved them. What a patriarch to the family. Brother Phillips says, I'm glad I've got to know you over these last 40 years of my life and your sons and what a great father you have been, Brother Phillips. We're honored to have you this morning. It says this in verse 1 of chapter 7. Now concerning the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Oh, so where are you going at with this one, Brother Roy? Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath the power of her own body, but the husband does. And likewise also the husband hath the power over his own body, but his wife has power over him. Defraud you not one another, except it be with the consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your lack of self-control. Okay, I want to talk a little bit here about the full life. What is Paul saying here? He said, boy, I think he's going to be preaching on sex this morning. Well, it will be mentioned a little bit, but I got to cover my bases because I got a lot of young people out here, and I want to be careful with this. But the first thing I want you to know, in a marriage that is full, it'll be a marriage that elevates marriage to a special relationship. And I believe that with all my heart. Marriage is a special relationship. God elevated it like that. There's no other relation like it in the world where two can come together and become one. God only does that in a marriage. No other way. But now we want to do it our way. Instead, the devil likes to devalue the marriage.
Amen.
Make it unimportant and something that's just a fly-by-night experience, a one-night stay, or a week's commitment, or a year's commitment. But God elevates marriage to something greater. And when you look at the subject of marriage in the Bible, and you find that it always depicts and describes it as a special relationship in life. The Bible says this, that in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, that marriage is honorable in all, and the bed is undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. So he elevates marriage. But I'm telling you, he lets those that violate that know that one day they will be judged. Yeah. If they want to live like a whoremonger, and they want to live like an adulterer, and they want to live that free life out there and do what they want to do, that's fine, but they will be judged. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4. It's a good verse to memorize, young people. Hallelujah. What Paul is saying here is there's certain types of sexual relationships that God prohibits. Amen? He prohibits it. He says here, now concerning the things whereof ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. That doesn't mean it's wrong to touch a woman like this. It's not wrong. But that word touch means to touch in such a way that it causes a passion to rise in you, a feeling of intimacy, a feeling of passion. It incites some kind of warmth in your heart towards that person in a wrong way that would lead you maybe to lust or to be enticed into a relationship that God has not ordained to be. And that's what he's saying. It's not good for us to do that. And we get in Christian circles now and all this lovey-dovey and hugging and everything else. And a little bit of hugging is fine. But I'm telling you, when you start out hugging your neighbor's wife, I'm telling you, you're asking for trouble, especially if it's my wife. Amen?
Amen?
And so God elevates it, though, and he says, I elevate this way. If you're not married, you shouldn't be having sex together. You shouldn't be parking out of the street. You shouldn't be living the life of a whoremonger or an adulterer or a fornicator. He says, I despise that. Hallelujah. Amen? I'm just telling you. So sex outside of marriage is prohibited. It's forbidden. It's condemned by God. And I don't care what our culture says. And I don't care what our courthouses do, what our judges say, it doesn't matter to me. I'm going to follow God's word. And Paul said that God hates this. And I hate it too. Amen? And so we need to elevate. And a full marriage will elevate marriage to something that's special. Till death do us part. Hallelujah. Divorce is not a word that we use in our home. We've been married for 43 years, and there's been ups and downs and fights and struggles and everything else. And few times, I'm telling you, my wife almost took the knife. Thank God I'm stronger than she is. Oh, she was tempted. Well, how many know you're not perfect? Raise your hand. You know you're not perfect. Raise your hand. Oh, raise your hand. Yes, David, get it up there. You preached that message last week like you're Mr. Perfect. Raise it high. Hey, we all stand there. The Bible's very clear, though. Hallelujah. What God's standard is, and he elevates it. Marriage is something that is special. Hallelujah. And this is where God says, I only permit sex in one way. When you're a husband and a wife. When the two come together, secretly make their vows before God, and come together as one and say, I do. The moment you say, I do, then the door is open and God says, now you can have an intimate relationship. You can, in fact, I even encourage you. It says, avoid fornication. Let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. So he was saying sex outside of that relationship is wrong, and God will not bless it. Hallelujah. Such God-given guidelines will elevate marriage and make it a special relationship. And I think about it, I have something special with my wife. 43 years special. Sometimes before she opens her mouth, I know what she's thinking. She'll say, why did you leave the room? And I said, knew what you was thinking. Knew what you was going to say before you said it. But the longer you're together, it seems like the more you look like each other, you feel like each other, you sing together, we enjoy. I used to hate going shopping with her. Dude, I used to hate it. And as I'm getting older, because I'm slowing down a little bit now, I move like this, I used to move a lot faster. I can keep up with her now. I mean, she can keep up with me. But I used to hate to shop with her now. I love to go shopping. I love to go out and do things. I love to go out and eat and things that I just never had time. Go, 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 go. And I love the bonding that it comes into that relationship over the years. And as long as your marriage, the more elevated your marriage becomes, the more full, the more blessed, the more wonderful. And I hate to see couples that they stay married for 10 or 15 years and then they break it off. They just missed the greatest years of their life. Now they go into debt, they get other marriages, and they got a child to pay what they got to make for, and all these other things, and they end up going struggling through life. And here we are at 60, almost 65 this year, and we are able to enjoy life a little bit for the first time. And we can do things together and plan trips and go here and do that and hold hands and smooch a little bit even in the car and drive down the road and talk about all of the wonderful things we've been through, the ups and downs and everything. And our marriage is full because we made it special. Because God made it special. And we told God we're going to do it your way, not our way. And I've messed up a lot of times, John. Thank God for a good woman and a good foundation that based on the Word of God, in spite of our failures, we kept it together, and now, hallelujah, we are enjoying our marriage like never before. I want to encourage you, elevate marriage to the place it needs to be. Young people, keep your virginity, keep your life for that special one that God has for you. Keep your life. I would love to marry you to that special. I'd like to counsel you. I counseled each one of my children's partner that they were going to marry. Counsel with them. Sit down and help them walk them through it. It started with Jeff Haney and then with Tisha. And then I had the joy of working with Gannon and helping him along the way. And then last of all was my son Ryan and Natalie. And I married all four of them. I got the privilege of seeing them say, I do. I'm finding back the tears and seeing God do something wonderful. I'm telling you, it's great. And it's sticking. It's holding. Why? Because they have been taught to do it God's way. They come running to me with the problem. I said, what does God say? Wives, submit yourself to your husband. Husband, love your wife. Hey, Ryan, are you loving Natalie like you need to love her? No, Natalie, kid, you need to repent right now. Get things right. Natalie, let him repent. Get down and back it right now, son. It works, man. They mess up. I tell them what they got to do to make it right. You know how I know? Because I've done it many, many times. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say it. We have so many empty homes because there's no love. It's empty of love. It's empty of respect. I'm telling you, it's crazy how this thing is going. It's supposed to be a special relationship. It's amazing how that when you first get married or when you're dating Courtney, you're opening every door and you're putting on her coat and you're doing this, you're pulling the seat out, you're doing all that. Once you get married, it's like, whoa, you got a different brain. Who did I know what happened here? Something's wrong. I'm telling you, it's because you stopped seeing it God's way. Something special. And to have a wonderful wife and have these wonderful blessings is just from God. A full marriage enjoys marriage as a satisfying relationship. I love this. One survey found that of the 5 marriages in 10 that hold together, only 10 to 20% of those could be called intimate marriages. Even though it looks like it's held together, inside that home, there's no satisfying relationship. None at all. It's just everybody's going their own way, doing their own thing, living their own world. They got their jobs and whatnot, and either they're sending that on the kids or on their jobs or whatnot. They hardly get together at all. It's just sad. One little boy took a history exam. One of the questions was, who was Patrick Henry? And he wrote, Patrick Henry was a man who got married. And then he said, give me liberty or give me death. Okay, I'm not going to repeat that. You just get together. There's all kinds of jokes about marriage. You get men together, they can tell them all. My wife says to me, I don't like that joke. I come over and tell her a good man's joke, you know. She says, I don't like that joke. Don't tell that to me again. Okay, honey. Learning the lesson. Now I keep the men jokes to the men. I don't take them home to my wife because she don't like that. And if you guys have any kind of grades at all, keep your men jokes to yourself and the guys. Laugh it out, but forget it when you get home because they don't like those kind of jokes at all. And we laugh at it, but I'm telling you, it's a sorry mess out there. And I can laugh at it because to me it's just a joke. But for a lot of people, it's sincere. For a lot of people, they don't want to go home. For a lot of people, they don't want to pound on that door and walk in that bedroom. They don't want to have that relationship because I'm telling you, they're not satisfied in the relationship. That's why they're going out here and going out there. I want to get home. I'm calling my wife and I'm on the way home. I'm on my way home. I'll be there in 20 minutes. Just letting you know I'm moving to St. Louis. I'm heading that way. And I want to get home. I long to walk through that door. There's just something satisfying, wonderful about it. And that's the way God wants it to be. Paul speaks here of marriage as a satisfying relationship. It says in verse 3, let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. That word due benevolence means a debt that is owed, or an obligation. And this debt is in the times, in the present tense. It means it's a continual debt that we owe, and we're to render to our mates. Due benevolence, this debt that we owe, the debt of what? The debt of love. The debt of respect. The debt of giving to them what they need. Hallelujah, to make their life satisfied, whether it's husband or wife, and each one has got their own different love language, their own different love language, and their own little struggles that they have in life. And sometimes the wife needs something tender and soft, and sometimes a guy needs to just come home and be with his wife in a special way. And it just varies from time to time. Sometimes there's tears, sometimes there's laughter, whatever is needed, they need to render to them the due benevolence. Whatever will fill their love bank, get in there and fill it for the glory of God. Hallelujah. Someone said the problem in many marriages today is the husband and the wife are behind in their payments. Someone said that troubles in marriage often begin when a man becomes so busy earning his salt that he forgets his sugar. A lot of truth to that. It says render. Render. That means keep doing it. Keep meeting your wife's needs. Wife, keep meeting your husband's needs. There's so many. It's not just sexual, even though that's the context here. It's not just sexual. There's so many needs that we have, emotional and struggles. And I mean, there's been times my wife came in one time, and I was on the floor in the bedroom. And it was a rough, this was years and years ago. I was on the floor, and I was just weeping. With struggles and battles within the church and discouraged. And my wife came in and she saw me and she said, I've never seen you like this before. And she got down there with me and encouraged me a little bit. And I said, I don't know. Africa was so easy. America is so difficult. Man, it was an adjustment for us to get through it. I thank God I have a wife who can be there to encourage me, wrap her arm around me. I've been able to be there for her, to lift her up. When she had hepatitis, come in the room every day, three times a week. Day, I'm going to read the Word of God to her. I cook dinner for her every day for 8 months. I cook dinner for my wife. It's a miracle she's alive. While we were building a Bible school and had churches going up and this happened and that happened, I mean, we was going 24/7, but I found time every day to come home and read the Word of God to her in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening. I would sit and read the Word of God to her and encourage her 8 good months. Because I love her. And it was pitiful. God raised her up. That was many, many, many moons ago. Hallelujah. I love it. My marriage has been satisfied. And it has to do with that responsibility of meeting her needs and within the rights of the marriage partner. Paul says in verse 4, the wife hath not power over her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband, hath not power over his own body, but the wife. That word power there speaks of one's rights, our authority, that which we hold so dear to us. It says, Paul says, doesn't belong to you now. When you get Hallelujah. Don't expect more of your husband than he deserves to have expected of him. Don't expect him to open the door for you. Be shocked when he does. And husbands, this is a word of caution. After this message, you better open the door for your wife when she's getting in that truck, or you're in big trouble, or car, wherever you go. Bobby, did you hear me? Yeah. Scott? Shock Sheila. What happened to him? Brain transplant. What? Just open the door for her. I do it till now. Not every time, but I would say what? 80% of the time I grab that door, open it up for you, and I'll run ahead of her. Get the door. Open it up for her. 43 years of doing this. Never grows old. I always get an honor out of doing that. Sometimes we're in a hurry or it's raining or whatnot, and we'll say we're all on our own then. But when this happens, get into the car, when I'm in a major hurry, I always go around, I open the door for her, and I want to protect her, I want to be there to bless her, and I want to satisfy her and let her know when we're walking down the mall, we walk hand in hand, we put your arms in me. Every once in a while I'll get ahead of her if I'm in a hurry, and she'll say, whoa, where are you going? Then I'll slow down, say, grab a hold of me. She says, well, I would, but you dragged me. I'm not a cavewoman. I said, okay, I'll slow down. Hallelujah. She's waiting for me to turn 85. So I'll slow down a little bit more. Paul says this is what we need to do. Hallelujah. You're not your own. When you get married, she becomes yours, you become hers. Vice versa. You're no longer on your own. If you want to live your life on your own, that's fine. You might be a happy camper, but your wife won't be. Not knowing a lot of husbands that treat their wives like slaves and treat them like dogs and everything else, and then they want sex at night. And I'm telling you, it don't work. And you might get it, but you'll never be satisfied. Do you hear me? I want my marriage to be satisfied. I want my wife to be satisfied. I want to be satisfied. I want to have a marriage like that that's filled with joy. To enjoy, not have an empty marriage, to enjoy marriage. How many would like to enjoy marriage?
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to ask you if you do, but I'm just going to ask you. I'm too wise for that. I got to stay here preaching. I got to go home and live it before my wife. That's why I tell you the good, the bad, and the ugly. I don't want to get home and say, oh, who was that up there preaching? I don't know that guy. A full marriage. It's one that will experience marriage as a spiritual relationship. Not just special, not just satisfying, but something that is spiritual. Hallelujah. I think that's beautiful. And that's what Paul says here. He says, verse 5, defraud ye not one another, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. What he's saying here is, if you want to separate and you don't want to have intimate relationships for a while, make sure you do it with consent. In other words, communicate. How many know that it's the number one cause of divorce? They don't communicate. Don't know what the other one's thinking. Don't get it. I'm telling you, we fail to communicate to everybody else but our wives. And my wife said,
amen.
Amen. That was weak, honey. I'm trying to confess my sins before I get home. I know people that spend more time on the internet chatting with people they do not know than they do with their wives or their husbands. Building relationships outside that are so dangerous and evil. I've never been on a chat room. I've never gone into that area or the internet in any way to do that kind of thing because it's so dangerous. Have no idea who you're tangling with. And see, young people are doing it all the time and building relationships with someone that tells them they're 18 and they're 28, they're 38, they're 68. And sometimes they're a police officer. Uh-huh, I like that one when it happens. So it should be a spirit, if it's God's way, and if it's a marriage that is full hallelujah, of him. I'm telling you, it'll be a marriage where there is consent, give and take, and you talk it over and you plan what you're going to do. Every major mistake I ever made was because I didn't get the consent of my wife. Every major mistake I made that I paid for years is because I did not get her consent. Get it, guys. Gals, get it from your husband. It's mutual. I'm telling you, wives, it'll make your marriage spiritual. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Let's go on. I'm closing up now. Only got one more page to go. This thing is, it says that we're to pray about things. We're to seek God. It talks there about praying, seeking the Lord, making it spiritual. How many guys pray with your wives? How many guys have ever prayed with your wife? Well, you might, when they're almost dead, you might pray for them then. But I think it should be a pattern in our life that almost on a daily basis, and I know there's always going to be times when you can't, but almost on a daily basis, sometime through the day. It might be a minute, it might be a 30-second prayer, it might be a 5-minute prayer, it might be 10, 15 minutes. You get your mate and you just pray for each other. Many times I'm in a great hurry and I will walk out the door and remember, have a prayer, I'll pull back in and lay my hands. She might be dead asleep and I'll just lay my hands on her and pray for her. She don't even know I'm praying, I'll just pray quietly. Other times, if I'm really having a bad day, I'll wake her up. A lot of times she just wakes up. And we pray. I believe every man should pray for their wife, and every wife should pray for their husband. And there should be that mutual coming together in spiritual matters. That's what Paul teaches here. And there needs to be this communication. I remember my wife and I were having a big fight. I don't know what I did. I can't remember what I did. I mean, she was so mad at me. This is some years ago. And I went into a room, and I was reading a book. I picked up this book on how to resolve problems, because I had a major problem. And they had 6 steps to resolve a problem and break down the communications. Guys, if you have a brain, you write this down. What do you do when your wife won't speak to you? What do you do when it's break down the communication? What do you do when all these things happen? Well, approach the wild stallion with a softness and a tenderness. Just come in. That's what I did. I read these things, and I said, I want to try it right now. I went into the bedroom, very quietly, carefully, making sure nothing was coming. Like a 22 shell or something like that. Honey, can we talk? I think I need to hear what's going on in your heart. I know I've hurt you. We need to talk. Will you talk to me? Please, will you talk to me? I love you. Please talk to me. And guess what? She opened up and started talking. Usually I would come and say, come on, we got to resolve this. We got to resolve this now. I got a day. I got this to go with this. Honey, we can't just go through the day mad at each other. Let's sit down and talk. That's the spiritual thing to do. Dads, I've done it. I know what works and what doesn't work. I've done it. I'm guilty. Approach with softness and tenderness. Get that down, David. Find out the problem by listening.
Amen.
Let them just talk. Are you getting this wrong? Get it. Let her talk. Might be there for 2 or 3 days, but let her talk. You know how I know this? Because all of us are guilty of this, guys. We don't want to talk. Let your wife communicate to you. Second, thirdly, agree with your spouse in the area where you're wrong. Most of the time, it'll be quite obvious if you listen. If you listen. And where you're wrong, agree. You're right. You're right. I'm sorry. You're right. You're right. You're right. Then humble yourself, fourthly, and ask for forgiveness. Fifthly, promise to work on that area of your life that is causing the conflict. Now, my wife's saying, I see his tactics now. So it's going to be a lot harder for me because she's going to know the moment I come in and say, honey, come on, we need to talk. Come on. She'll say, uh-huh, number one. Let's see what number two is. She's probably writing all these down. I'm cooked. I'm cooking myself right now in the top burner. And last of all, give her a big hug and tell her that you love her. And do it sincerely. I've done this many times with my wife, haven't I? We've walked through this. I might have missed a couple steps, but I walked through it and built that kind of communication. And I mess up, but I'm telling you, this works. It really does. And it will cause your relationship to become spiritual. Something that God is honored with, and God will bless you. It's marriage that is full of God, full of joy. Marriage that's elevated. Marriage that brings, makes marriage sacred, makes it spiritual, makes it something wonderful with God. And with your mate. And I believe with all my heart that couples, and this has been proven, that pray together, stay together. And they say, I know that I heard that the same divorce rate is in the church that's in the world. But let's turn it around. You give me Christians that pray together. You give me couples that read the Word of God together, that go to church together, that are in life groups together. They do things together. I'm telling you, there's no power in hell that can separate that bond, that relationship. This is not going to church, not just saying you're a Christian and putting on that big front, but when you live the life in the home and out of the home, and everyone knows you're a Christian, your kids know it, they see it, and you live that consistent life, there's no power in hell that can tear your marriage apart. There's no power that can empty it and destroy it. And believe me, the devil's out to do that. I want to read it to you. I want you to get this and get it real good and understand the tactics of the devil. He says this: defraud you not one another, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourself to fasting and prayer and come together again, that Satan, everyone say it, Satan, tempt you not for your lack of self-control and your self-control there and in any area of your life. And I got news for you. What I'm trying to get across is there is an enemy out to destroy your marriage. You better name him by his name. His name is Satan. It's not Robert. It's Satan. It's not Bambi. It's Satan. Satan, call it by the right word. It's a devil. And he's alive and he's well, and he will tempt you and try you and test you and do everything he can to devour you. He's a roaring lion seeking, and he's attacking one main part, and that is your marriage. And if he can get you there, he's got you everywhere. And it's a mutual, husband and wife. And I know some of you are struggling because you've got a husband that's an unbeliever or not wanting to do it the right way. That's really a battle. That's really a test. And I know I've never been there, so I don't understand that test and trial that you're going through in life. But all I know is I've got a God that can take care of every situation by the power of prayer, and fasting, and believing. Sometimes it might have to be by death or sickness or affliction. God's got a way of getting his way if we'll seek him with all of our heart. Amen. So I'm here to say this morning, I don't want an empty marriage. I want a full marriage to overflow. I'm in this to the end. Hallelujah. But I'm enjoying it now more than I've ever enjoyed it before in my life. And I've enjoyed marriage. People say, how do you handle it? How do you handle all these problems? It's because when I walk home, I walk in my house, it's full of peace. It's full of love. It's full of joy. It's full of long suffering. It's full of kindness. It's full of goodness. It's full of mercy. It's full of faith. It's full. It's full of just self-control and temperance and all the beautiful fruits of the Spirit. When I walk into my home, you know what I feel? I feel God. And I'm so blessed. And the wisest decision I ever made in my life is when I asked that woman right out there, will you marry me? After we courted for a couple years, gave her a pre-engagement ring, and then asked her to marry me. And a year later, after 4 years, she finally said yes, and I do. And that was the beginning of our marriage. I don't regret that for one second. Blessed with four wonderful children, 11 grandchildren, and they're serving God, fulfilling His purpose and plan for their life. I'm telling you, that's how I can live with myself. My mistakes, my failures, and everything else. One thing I've always done right is I've wanted to do it God's way. Even when I messed up, I still wanted to do it God's way. And it works. Amen. Young people, listen to me. You make some wrong decisions in life, and when you make them, you'll live with that the rest of your life. When it comes to marriage and relationships, make sure you make the right choice. Make sure you come and talk to me and Sister Roy. When you're thinking about marriage, thinking about somebody, heed, I'm telling you, you girls worry me to death. I see it, Dave and Crystal, if I have a heart attack, he comes to me and says, Brother Roy, what should we do? I said, send him in my office. Get him, bring him in here. Serious. I love these kids. I want to see them serve God. I want them to fulfill God's purpose for their life. I want you to be happy and to have joy and to have what I have in my home. I look for all of you to come and live in our home and see the joy we have and the experience. Ask David. David lives with us. He sees it every day. We're there. We have some bad days. Compared to all the wonderful times we have, it's just like nothing. He's been with us for a year. I'm going to pray. Bring him in. Hallelujah. I want him to feel what I feel every day of my life. It's real. It's wonderful. And I have a full marriage. And I want it to not only be a full marriage. I want them coming up with a new episode now. What's that new episode? The Fuller Marriage. How many of you thought of that? Remember the Full House? Yeah. Full House back in 83, 95. Hey. That's fine. So I never got twice a day after because I never saw one episode of it. I don't even know what it's all about. I just heard that seen on the internet that they're coming up with the Fuller House. I said, okay, to try. But I don't want a full house. I don't want a full home. I want a full marriage. Amen. Amen? That's satisfying. And I can just say, we're living it. We're living proof that it works. Do it God's way. Amen. And I'm telling you, you're blessed. Okay, where you're coming from, you start doing God's way today, and you'll find God in your home. Lord, take this word, plant it deep in our hearts. Lord, especially the new couples that are just getting started in marriage, the tests and the trials that are going to come their way are unbelievable. Let them always realize the enemy is there to destroy them. I pray, God, you grant them the grace and the wisdom to know how to resist the devil that he might flee from them. Hold their marriages together, all of our couples together. We just rejoice with Wayne and Susie, 48 years, Pat and Dave, all these years married. We rejoice with you over Rich and Marie, God, 40 years coming up, God. What a joy. We think of the relationships that you built within this church. Give us solid foundations, God. I pray you bring more families, and the ones that are here, that we get more and more stable and more strong, and that you would raise up, Lord, an army of families, full marriages, filled with God, so that no power in hell can defeat what you want to do here at Bethel. And I will praise you for it. I ask it in Jesus' name. I want all the couples to stand. All the singles, the ones that are married, their mates aren't here. I want you to stand. Because you really have a battle going on. You just got a battle going on. Your mates aren't here. You're married, but your mates aren't here. And we'd love for them to be here. And that's not easy. I want you to look around. Know that you're a target. You're a target. I want you to know Pastor Roy and Sister Roy are praying for you. I don't think there's one, not one family in this church that we've not wept and prayed for and cried to God for and rejoiced for. Sometimes our prayers are personal. Or other times I say, God, thank you for sending on and on to our church. Thank you for that. Keep them stronger, Lord. Powerful. Prayed for Tracy Clark. Hard to get to see Clark. He works all the time. Oh, I love Clark. Whenever he comes around here, I always wonder, how do I live without Clark? I mean, the guy is so servant. Wish he could be here. And I only know that day's coming. But heart goes out. Hardly know Jared. Just didn't know him. But all I know is when I go there, I get a free cup of coffee. Got to know his wife. And my neighbor, hallelujah. I love him. And I love his spirit. And pray for you and your wife. And for Kevin, many, many times. Keep doing that. Everyone here. Brother Phillips, I pray for you through all that you've been through this last year. It's been the toughest year of your life. You think when you get your age, you've pretty much seen everything. Man, what you went through, I wept for you. I just said, oh God, wrap your arms around it. Keep it. Such losses. I'm telling you, we need each other. So I want you to look around, see these couples here. And I want you to pray for them. Pray for them. Look around. Get their faces. Cindy and Jane, Jimmy, Michelle, James and Sarah, David, Crystal. Who's your husband? Oh, it's back in the window. Jessica, Tim, all of them. We need each other. We need to pray for one another. And so I want you to find another couple here, and I want you to pray for them. Amen? I want you to pray for them. And then my wife, if you come here, honey, we want to pray for the single ones that are standing, their husbands are here. We want to pray for them. Before you leave, I want you to pray for at least one family. You singles, don't go anywhere until we pray for you today. And we're honored to have you in our church. We're honored for you to be a part of Bethel. Now let's build this upon God's way, His design. God bless you for that. Amen. Let's pray. Find someone who's right here.